Hello and welcome. I'm James Murphy, and today we're going to be testing to see how fast is Python's built-in sort. Well, I've already got the code here. Let's just uncomment it. You see, I make a list, I shuffle it up, and then I time how long it takes to sort it and print it out. So let's see how long it takes. Well, there you go, 207 microseconds. End of the video, right? Well, no. Obviously, there are a ton of things wrong with the way that I tried to profile this. For one, I'm recording the video at the same time that I ran the test, and that's definitely going to affect the speed. If I want to measure the performance of sort in a more reliable way, better than this quick and dirty implementation, then I'm going to have to put a little bit more thought into it. So for starters, I've listed out here some of the common things that affect the performance of a sort. These first four are obvious things. The performance can also depend on less obvious things, like the order that you run the tests in. This is a very common trap that people fall into if you're not familiar with performance testing. Consider this case, for example. I have two functions, function and function two, and I want to see which one is faster. So I write the most obvious thing. I just profile them one at a time. I run it, see how much time it took, and then I run the second one and see how much time it took. Well, let's do it. So in this case, we can see 671 versus 417. So it looks like function two is better, right? Well, just to be sure, let's run it again. Okay, this time it was about 500 versus 300, so the numbers were a little bit different, but it still definitely looks like the second one is better. Okay, so what are these two functions? Well, the first one, I was just converting a range of 10,000 integers to a list, and the second function, I was, it's exactly the same function. So you can see that it's not function one or function two that's slower, it's whichever one ran first is the slower one. And in addition to all these things, of course it matters what else is running on your machine at the same time, and all kinds of wild things can affect the performance. That's why performance testing is actually a very, very subtle and tricky field. What I'm going to show you here today, of course, is only going to be applicable for my computer, my operating system, my version of Python, and everything else that's specific to just my machine. But the source code is on the GitHub page, so if you want to see how fast your sort is, then feel free to run the code yourself. Okay, so let's get started. So the first thing that I'm going to define is a sorting test case. This specifies everything that you need to run a single test for a single size one time. Then you can run the test as many times as you want to get better data about your test case. The size here is meant to represent the size of the list that you're going to be sorting. The seed allows me to ensure that I have a reproducible test case every time. This data maker is another class that we're defining. Essentially, its job is to take in the size and seed and give you some data. So part of a test case is you need to generate some data and then sort it. So the data maker tells you how to generate the data, and then the sort keyword arguments tell you what arguments you pass to the sort. Finally, this field of times is where we store the results of our runs of the test. So let's take a look at this DataMaker class. Well, in actuality, there's not much in DataMaker. It is an abstract base class. It's essentially defining an interface. All I'm saying is that anything that claims to be a DataMaker needs to have a make method. It needs to take in the size and the seed and produce a list of data that we're going to sort. The compatible keys and compatible sort keyword arguments functions here are not really important at this stage. They're essentially just saying for this type of data maker, what kind of things can you call the sort function with? So what is an example of a data maker? Well, the simplest thing is how about random integers? So you can see an implementation of a data maker is very simple. All I do is specify this make function. I use the numpy seed function to seed the numpy random generator. And then I use numpy random to generate random integers between, you know, some low and high of the given size. And then I convert that to a list. So this would be your typical most common sorting case. You're just sorting integers. For this data maker, it's a sorted uniform int maker, meaning I start by getting uniform ints and then I sort them. So this is going to be useful for testing how long does sort take on data that's already sorted. And then you could have something like nearly sorted, which is I start out with something sorted and then make 10 random swaps in it. Does that affect things? I don't know. We'll find out. The rest of these are just slight variations on the same idea with different types or different, you know, extra parameters. So uniformly distributed floats between 0 and 1, same thing as the previous, but sorting them. What if I generate using a Gaussian distribution or normal distribution instead of a uniform distribution? This maker looks at the case where there aren't that many choices of what the answer could be. So you could see my low here is 0 and the high is 32. So there's only 33 choices of possible answer. And then these two just make random strings or sorted random strings. Finally, for data makers, I've defined a class here, toInts and a string. This is meant as a stand-in. In your code, you have defined some classes, and for whatever reason, you don't want them to be just, you know, a tuple or something. It's a real class. Pretend that it has extra methods and it does things. And its only data members are X, Y, and S. So how long does it take to sort a class that has a, you know, built-in less than operator? Then this maker just makes random int, and then random strings, and then plops them into the toInts and a string class and returns a list of those. So this one is the same as the previous one, except instead of storing X, Y, and Z in this class, toInts and a string, we're going to store it just in a tuple. And now we're back down to the sorting test case. So you can see now what this is. We have our size seed data maker. So this is going to be something like our uniform int maker, which is going to tell us, okay, given this size and seed, go ahead and make me some data. Then what does the run do? Well, it just times how long does it take to sort. So it does the timing and then appends the time to the end of the times list. The next function I want to look at is this make all test cases. Basically, it takes in a list of sizes, seeds, and data makers that you want to test, and then it creates all the test cases and then puts them in a big list of test cases. Once I have my big list of test cases, I pass it to this function, run tests n times, which actually does something very important. So in order to counteract the problem that we saw at the beginning, where the order that we run the tests in affects the answer to the, you know, performance test, in order to counteract that, we're actually going to shuffle our tests. So we're going to shuffle them and then run all of them, and then shuffle them and then run all of them, and so on and so forth this many times. Once I run all my tests, then I'm going to convert them to a pandas data frame for easy processing and plotting. And then I will make a plot out of it. So let's see how it's all put together in main. First off, we have this recompute results. If this is true, that means you want to actually run all the tests. And once you run the test, it's actually going to save it to a file, save the results to a file, so that if you just want to show the plot again and not rerun all the tests again, you can just set this to false and then rerun it. This parameter just lets you choose whether or not you also want to show the reverse sorts in the same plot. Then here are the important things. So what sizes are we going to be testing? Well, range 1024, so the numbers 0 to 1023. And what seeds am I using? Well, 0 through 9. And then finally, trials is the number of times that I'm going to run every single test case. So same seed, same size, I'm going to run every single one 20 times. Then here I have my list of data makers, and you can see I just make an instance of each of those maker classes. I'm just going to test everything. So you can see if we want to recompute the results, then we make all the test cases, run them n times, convert them to a data frame, and then pickle them to a file. If we don't want to recompute things, then we hit this else and just read the existing file and then filter out the data makers that we're not interested in. So of course, I can't run this code while I'm recording. So I'm going to go ahead and do that offline and then show you the results that I got, which are then going to be saved into this file. The first thing that I notice is that there are definitely clumps of twos. So you can see for each of these lines, there's essentially two colors, and that's because the reverse sort and the forward sort are taking essentially the same time. Okay, so let's comment out these and just look at the ints. So the first thing that I notice is, what are these down at the very bottom? So if I click on these, you can see that these sorted ones are the ones down at the bottom. So Python is definitely doing something that's a lot faster for already sorted arrays. I also notice that the reverse sort is always slightly above the normal sort. That kind of makes sense, because to do a reverse sort, you just reverse, sort, and then reverse. Or that's how Python does it anyway. Okay, let's get rid of the sorted ones and the reversed ones. So the difference between these three curves is essentially due to the distribution. So This pink one is the uniform. The blue one is the one that was uniform, but there were only a few choices. So the blue one had a lot of overlaps. And then the green one was nearly sorted. So it wasn't as fast as the ones that were already sorted, but it does seem to be quite a bit faster than the ones that aren't sorted. So here are the floats, and again, we see that the reverse ones are pretty similar to the non-reversed ones. So let me just hide those. And again, we see that the already sorted one is the fastest one by a large margin. And then the difference between these two is whether it was a uniformly distributed float or a normally distributed or Gaussian distribution. So we can see that whether it's uniform or normal makes essentially no difference for floats. Let's move on to strings. Once again, the sorted ones are much faster, and reverse sorting a sorted collection of strings is doing significantly worse than the sorted version, but significantly better than just random. However, just for random strings, reverse sorting is just about the same as normal sorting. All right, let's finally go to 2 ints and a string, and we see something very surprising for this one. Well, first, let me note, unsurprisingly, sorting this struct took quite a bit longer than sorting just an integer. But the surprising thing is here, look at the difference between sorting a class versus sorting a tuple that contains the same information as the class. The reverse sorting is essentially the same as the forward sorting. Now we just see the difference. This blue line is trying to sort a list of elements of a class, and the green line is sorting the same exact elements, but just stored in a tuple. That's a huge difference. Yeah, so this is like 1/10 the time scale. So that's an interesting find. All right, let me just put the picture back up where I'm not going to show any of the reverse plots, and I'm not going to show any of the sorted things, just so we can get one final glimpse at the picture of how long it takes to sort. So this is kind of the final picture that you can take away from this process. But I just want to reiterate some of the lessons that we've learned through exploring this data. So the final answer to the question, how fast is Python's built-in sort, is it depends. It depends on how much you're sorting, what type of data, what the parameters of the sort are, what's the distribution of the data, and all kinds of different other things completely unrelated to the data. So there's no real one answer. Of course, the real point of this video is that if you want to measure performance and you want a reliable answer, you need to test it yourself on your own hardware in a production setting where you're going to be using it. You need to control as many of these different variables as you can and make them as realistic as possible. So sorry if the title was clickbait. As always, thanks for watching. Don't forget, if you liked the video, leave a like, and if you especially liked the video, consider subscribing. See you in the next one.